Hi everyone, my name is Lavina, and I'm excited to chat with you about custom data stores in SwiftData, a way to use SwiftData with your own persistence backend. Custom data stores are a new feature in SwiftData that allow you to use any document, file format, or persistence backend of your choice. And they work great with all of your existing SwiftData code. Here, in the implementation for the Sample Trips app, I can change the type of store just by replacing the model configuration with the JSON store configuration, an example I will implement later in this video. With just this one replacement, the model container now knows to use a different store type, without requiring me to change any of the model or view code in the Sample Trips app. In this video, I will first introduce the role a store plays in SwiftData and how it interacts with the model context and model container. Then, I'll explore how they are built using the new DataStore protocol. Finally, I'll cover the essentials of implementing a custom data store by taking you through an example that uses a JSON file for persistence. At a high level, the store is responsible for fetching and saving all of the data required to support the persistent models. To explore how custom data stores work in SwiftData, I'm going to examine how they provide persistence for my app, Sample Trips. Sample Trips is built on the powerful synergy of SwiftUI and SwiftData. And a typical app is composed of three important parts. SwiftUI provides the user interface, typically a view, like a list or label, that displays data from a model in a model context. The model context reads and writes data using a store in a model container. In this video, I'm going to focus specifically on the role the store plays in SwiftData. Sample Trips uses a model context to power the view and display the trips. The model context instantiates persistent models for each trip in the view. Each of these trips also have a corresponding persistent identifier that uniquely identifies the model. And the model context tracks the changes I make so they can be saved to the store when needed. For example, if I decide to cancel my trip to Los Angeles and also add a new trip to Tokyo, these changes are tracked by the model context. When the new Tokyo model is inserted into the model context, it is identified by a temporary persistent identifier. When the model context saves, it tells the store to delete the Los Angeles trip and insert the new Tokyo trip. The store will then assign the Tokyo model a permanent persistent identifier, trip5, and map it to its former temporary identifier, trip t1, in a process known as remapping. The store then responds to the model context with the updated persistent identifier for the Tokyo trip. After the model context finishes updating its state, the UI can update the view rendering the trips. Persisting changes is just one example of how the model context and store work together to support persistent models in SwiftData. They communicate using a set of requests and responses that define operations like fetch or save. The store's role is to provide the implementation for how model values are persisted. This communication leverages a sendable, codable representation of the model called the DataStore snapshot. In the Sample Trips app, the view communicates with the model context using persistent models. However, when the model context needs to communicate with a store, it creates a snapshot to hold the current state of the model. The snapshot is a sendable, codable container of the values in the model at that point in time. Like persistent models, each is identified by a persistent identifier. The store then consumes these snapshots and applies the values to its storage. And the reverse is also true. When data is read by the model context from the store creates a set of snapshots that align with the persistent models the context is asking for. The model context then creates persistent models for each snapshot for use in views, queries, or other work the context is doing. Stores play a critical role in SwiftData, allowing the model context to read and write model data to any storage format. Let me take you through the new DataStore protocol and how it makes this possible. There are three key parts to a store: a configuration to describe the store, snapshots to communicate model values with the model context, and a store implementation that the model container can manage. Each of these parts conform to three different protocols: DataStore configuration, DataStore snapshot, and DataStore. The default store in SwiftData provides its own implementation of these types: model configuration, default snapshot, and the default store. The default store supports all the rich features of SwiftData, like migration, history tracking, and CloudKit sync, and it encapsulates the platform's best practices for performance and scalability, making it the best default choice for persisting models. The DataStore protocol defines all of the functionality SwiftData needs for the store to be usable by the model context, including save, fetch, and caching. Additional protocols define optional DataStore features, like the new history protocol for describing all of the changes made to the store. The model context communicates with stores using requests and responses from the DataStore protocol. For example, when fetching data from a store, the model context sends the store a DataStore fetch request containing the fetch descriptor that describes the data the store should retrieve. Once the store retrieves the model values, it creates a snapshot for each model and returns them in a DataStore fetch result. Then, the model context creates a persistent model for each of the snapshots. A similar process happens when models are changed in the model context and save is called. The model context creates a DataStore save changes request containing snapshots for all of the modified models and sends the request to the store. Then, the store applies the snapshots to its storage and creates a DataStore save changes result to send back to the model context. In the result, the store provides a map of the remapped identifiers for any newly inserted models, like trip T1. This tells the model context to update the persistent identifier for the inserted trip to trip 5. Finally, the model context processes the save result from the store and updates its state, assigning the new permanent persistent identifier to the inserted trip. Now that I've covered the mechanics of a data store, I want to explore what it's like to actually implement one. I'll implement a store that uses a JSON file to persist the models in the Sample Trips app. Before I get started, there are two points I'd like to clarify. This store is an archival store, meaning the entire file is loaded when reading or writing. Additionally, I'll be using the JSON coders provided by Foundation and storing data as an array of snapshots in the file. The first step to creating a store is to declare the configuration and store types that conform to the DataStore configuration and DataStore protocols. These types reference each other using associated types. On the configuration, I set the store type as JSON store, and on the store, I set configuration to JSON store configuration. Additionally, the JSON store declares the type of snapshot it uses to communicate with the model context. Here, I am using the default snapshot because I don't need to customize the encoding or decoding of the model data. Now, I can begin implementing the two required methods for a data store to be usable with the model context: fetch and save. When the model context sends a DataStore fetch request, I need to load the data that's in the store and instantiate a DataStore fetch result. Because the default snapshot is codable, I can use the JSON decoder to load the data for the store from the file URL provided by the configuration. Then, I'll instantiate and return a DataStore fetch result with the snapshots from the file. Currently, this implementation doesn't process the predicate or sort comparators that are on a fetch descriptor. The translation of a predicate or sort comparator can be an involved process, and I can instead use the model context to perform this work for me. To do this, I'll throw the prefer in memory filter and prefer in memory sort errors when the request contains a predicate or sort descriptor. This works great for my case because this is a small data set that can be loaded into memory. I now have a fully functional fetch implementation that can support queries and sorting. With fetch implemented, I can implement save to write the snapshots into the JSON file. When implementing save, I want to consider and handle three types of changes: insertions, updates, and deletions. Before I begin processing the incoming snapshots in the save request, I first have to read in the current contents of the file, which I handle in a separate method I defined called read. I'll organize all of the snapshots into a dictionary keyed by their persistent identifier, which will be my working copy for the new JSON file that would be written to disk at the end. Then, I process the snapshots of the inserted models within the save request. This involves assigning and remapping identifiers for each inserted snapshot. Let me examine this in a little more detail. Recall that when models are inserted into the store, each model contains a temporary identifier that's not associated with any store. For each inserted snapshot here, I create a new permanent persistent identifier. I then create a copy of the snapshot that uses the new persistent identifier. This new persistent identifier is mapped to the temporary one in the remapped identifiers dictionary to return to the model context later in the save result. Finally, I add the inserted snapshots to the ones initially loaded from the file. After processing the inserted snapshots, I process the updates by replacing the snapshots from the file with the ones in the save request. And finally, I remove the deleted snapshots from those loaded from the file. I now have a complete and updated set of data in the snapshots by identifier dictionary that I want to write back to the file. I'll use a JSON encoder to write this working copy of the snapshots back to disk in a single JSON file. Finally, I return a DataStore save changes result with the results of the save. The DataStore save changes result includes the remapped persistent identifiers for the context to update. Now that I have a complete custom DataStore, I can adopt it in sample trips. In the app definition, I can change the type of store just by replacing the model configuration with the JSON store configuration. With just this one replacement, the model container now knows to use a different store type without requiring me to change any of the model or view code in the Sample Trips app. With DataStore, SwiftData can read and write data to any storage format or persistence backend. This allows you to use the power of SwiftUI and persistent model with any document, database, or cloud storage you need, while the model context helps reduce the complexity of simple store implementations by providing filtering and sorting for you. Adopting a custom store in SwiftData is as straightforward as just changing the data store configuration. And with the new data store protocol, you can implement support for any persistence backend. This opens SwiftData to a huge range of new possibilities. Be sure to check out what's new in SwiftData to learn about other new features like indexing and unique constraints. And don't miss track model changes with SwiftData history to learn all about how you can examine the history of a store. Thanks for joining me. I can't wait to see what you build.